1.2 billion people make India the world's largest democracy. But behind this oft-repeated statistic is an even bigger reality. India's mammoth population is also amongst the most diverse. Spread across 29 states and 7 union territories, and speaking countless languages and dialects, India is also diverse along socio-economic literacy and urban and rural divides. Governance, then, is a challenge, more today than ever before. How can an over 1 billion strong nation be united under the same standards of governance? Watch as ICT lends a hand. What does it mean to govern a country like India? It means providing essential services like infrastructure, healthcare, education, transportation, livelihood, and communication, etc., to all citizens in an equal and efficient manner. It means providing transparency and openness in all issues related to public welfare. It also means ensuring no Indian is left behind when it comes to getting their basic rights. But there are many challenges to even providing basic services in a country like India. This is the Ramnagar Taluk in Karnataka. It is home to mulberry farmers like Shivadurayya, who have cultivated these lands for generations. Today he has a rather common problem that all farmers face at some point in their lives.
ಈಗ ನಮ್ಮಂದು ಮತ್ತು ನಮ್ಮ ಕೋ ಬ್ರದರ್ಸ್ದು ಸೇರಿಸಿ 6 ಎಕರೆ ಜಮೀನಿದೆ ಅದು ಒಂದೇ ಪಣಿಲಿ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ
ಮೈ ಬ್ರದರ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ಕೋ ಓನ್ 6 ಏಕರ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಐ ವಾಂಟೆಡ್ ಸಿಂಗಲ್ ಓನರ್ಶಿಪ್ ಆಫ್ ದ 3 ಏಕರ್ಸ್ ಬಿಲಾಂಗಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಮೀ ದ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಮಾರ್ಕ್ಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟರ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಮೈ ನೇಮ್ ಸೋ ದಟ್ ದೇರ್ ವಾಸ್ ನೋ ಫ್ಯೂಚರ್ ಲಿಟಿಗೇಷನ್ ವಿತ್ ಮೈ ಬ್ರದರ್ಸ್ ವಿ ಅಪ್ಲೈಡ್ ಫಾರ್ ರಿಜಿಸ್ಟರಿಂಗ್ ದ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಡಿಡ್ ದ ಡಾಕ್ಯುಮೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಟುಕ್ ಪೊಸೆಷನ್
In order to do any transaction related to his lands, farmers like Shivadurayya need documents like RTC or record of rights, tenancy and crops. But getting these official certificates isn't always easy.
2000 isvi inda hinde kai barvanige pani thobekaitu kai barvanige pani
thob The documentation was done manually and we were at the mercy of the secretary. Who used to make us run from pillar to post. We had to track him down in the village or taluk offices. It took up to 15 days to trace him for processing the RTC. After the RTC, the process was delayed in the surveyor's office with unconvincing excuses like the application is lost and can't be found.
Shivadurayya's case brings to light India's biggest challenges in governance. Lack or inadequate access to services, lack of efficiency, and lack of transparency in procedures. But the situation isn't so bleak, because Indian governance is slowly but surely shedding its old ways and making the delivery of public services a high-tech affair. At the turn of the millennium, India was experiencing a boom in the information technology sector. It was then that an idea began to gain momentum. Could information and communication technology, or ICT, make governance simpler, faster, and more efficient? In 2006, the Government of India launched the National E-Governance Plan, or NEGP. The backbone of the NEGP was the Department of Electronics, Information and Technology, or DITI. E-governance uses the tools of ICT to make government services smart, or simple, moral, accountable, responsive and transparent. So what exactly are the ICT building blocks for e-governance? Computerization across each district of India. This includes end-to-end solutions from hardware to software. a reliable tele and mobile connectivity, and strong digital networks to connect every e-governance portal to users across India. And an IT-enabled workforce of public servants who can facilitate the delivery of e-governance services. In the early days of the NEGP, India had to build its ICT capability from the ground up. Fortunately, it had some resources which were already in place. In 1987, the National Informatics Center, or NIC, launched the NICnet. NICnet was designed to be a national satellite-based computer network. Once NICnet was launched, it undertook one of the most ambitious ICT projects, computerizing each district in India.
Actually, all the government programs, the back-end digitization is, and the digital media and the computerization of all various projects is a way to make things very easily accessible to citizens, as well as to streamline a lot of services. So the easiest way to do it is to employ IT at the back end.
With initiatives to bring digital platforms even to India's rural and remote areas, there's a new wave of ICT-enabled governance sweeping India. And it's even reaching farmers like Shivadurayya in Ramnagar Taluk, thanks to initiatives like Bhumi. In 2000, the government of Karnataka took a bold step to digitize the entire land record system in the state under the Bhumi project. For the first time in India, land records were digitized and made available for the public to access them from any revenue office in the state. Over 2 crore land records called RTCs were collected from 10,000 locations spread across Karnataka, and they were entered into a database. It was the biggest data entry operation for that time. The Bhumi project stood for another key feature. Unlike most digital data that users like you and I are familiar with, these records were all in the local language of Kannada. It took over 1 year and nearly 1,000 trained IT staff to digitize each land record. Today, nearly 203 database servers are present across Karnataka. That means that farmers like Shivadurayya can access his papers not just from his own taluk, but from any other concerned office across the state. All it takes is a fee of 50 rupees, and what once took months can be done in just a few days or even hours.
Once a farmer gives an application in my kiosk, we have totally cut off the link, that is the contact between the farmer and the village accountant. That was in the previous system where all these corruptions, all those favorisms were happening. To that extent, it has reduced our burden and it has helped the farmers. So the delay which was there in the village accountant system, that has been totally eradicated now.
As for Shivadurayya, the convenience is a boon.
Post-computerization, we get our documents on the day we make the request or the next day at the most. Records from all the villages are available here.
Thanks to Bhumi, close to 1 lakh RTCs are issued in a month. The model became so successful that since 2008, the Karnataka government has stopped using manual RTCs altogether. Bhumi is now a pioneering technology project that is replicated by many other states in India, like Uttar Pradesh and Maharashtra. But perhaps its biggest success is its integration with Indian banks. Nearly 80% of farmers need these land records for agricultural loans. Now, with the help of Bhumi's data, banks can process loan applications faster than before. From a tedious process to a simple click and print model, Bhumi has transformed one of the most complex public services into a simple, easy-to-use digital service. Then in 2014, the Digital India wave swept India. And NIC unveiled its most ambitious e-governance initiative till date, Meghraj, or the National Cloud. Before Meghraj came along, each government department had to run its own digital infrastructure. It had to procure its own servers to store and process digital information. It needed to maintain and look after all back-end services like data centers. For this, it needed its own dedicated team of IT-trained personnel. This was a challenge for government departments, which were already grappling with their primary responsibilities. But now, thanks to Meghraj, this job has been handed over to the cloud. The cloud is a centralized virtual resource that different government departments can buy or rent instead of maintaining their own IT infrastructure.
Each government department doesn't need to buy their own services. They don't need to set up their own data centers. They don't need to really put huge infra in place. They can very easily just say that we need 5 servers today or 10 servers. They start off on their application. Tomorrow they want to expand, they ask for more. Otherwise they would have had to keep that kind of an infra throughout. Now they don't need to do that. They just take maybe extra some resource at that point and they manage.
Meghraj, or the National Cloud, is very easy to use thanks to its graphical interface.
We have a link here, Get Cloud Service. So on this screen, user gives the input, the basic details. We capture this detail and then we process it and we give another account where user tells us what resources requires. So after the user logs in, this shows us all the facilities which user can avail. User can tell us what type of server it needs and also how many servers it needs, whether it's a Windows or Linux or MySQL server or SQL server, like that. For example, here the user is requesting for a 1 GB RAM and a 1 core server of a Linux based server in a production environment, and it with an additional storage, additional disk for a server of about 30 GB. And the user needs only one server and submit the request. So this resource user asks and this request come to us, and when we receive a request from user that what type of resources they want, then we give them a final user password for cloud dashboard. Cloud dashboard is that area from where user can access the whole cloud, its own servers, and can manage their servers from dashboard. So my cloud is an area where user can see how many VMs, and in a user in its account, user can have multiple projects. Like in a departments, we can have a multiple projects. So they can see the users for each project. The organization can see total resource, how much they have used. Suppose they have taken 10 GB. Out of 10 GB, they have used 4 GB. They have still 6 GB free. So this type of information user can get from this dashboard.
Thanks to the National Cloud, now government departments need focus only on service providing and leave the IT management to NIC's professionals.
You have got full liberty. You got everything in that cloud, wherein you yourself at any point of time access to your area, have network, storage, or even more servers, compute, everything. So all you get in once, and you can manage, you can change a lot of configurations because all have been given to you. So it becomes very transparent. The time he asks for any service, he gets also, and he sees the billing also. So is this such kind of model which is very transparent between both the provider and the user, makes that also very feel good factor for to avail and get encouragement to go for these kind of services.
Thanks to such digital revolutions, Indian governance can be transformed. After the break, we'll see how ICT transformed one of the biggest public services, not just in India, but in fact, the world.
मेरे प्यारे देशवासियों, IT to society, मैं नहीं हम, अहम नहीं वयम।
प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी आगामी रविवार को मन की बात के जरिए 50वीं बार जनता से सीधे रूबरू होंगे।
उसका शुरू का योजना थी, उसकी उसकी थिंकिंग थी वो यही थी कि देश की जो सामाजिक मुद्दे हैं उनको कैसे देश के बीच में लिया जाए, और अगर प्रधानमंत्री उसके बारे में बोलते हैं तो वो एक मूवमेंट बन जाता।
पत्रकारिता के साथ जुड़े हुए विद्यार्थी अब शोध करने लगे हैं इस एक्सपेरिमेंट के ऊपर, पीएचडी की डिग्री के लिए अप्लाई करने लगे हैं इस एक्सपेरिमेंट पर।
देखिए, आमतौर पर ये धारणा रही है कि कुछ नहीं हो सकता, देश में कोई सुनवाई नहीं है, लोगों में कुंठा जमा होती है, लोगों में फ्रस्ट्रेशन होती है, लेकिन जब उनकी बात की सुनवाई हो जाए तो आधा गुस्सा तो लोगों का इसी में निकल जाता है कि हमारी बात कम से कम सुनी गई या हमारी बात कहने का मौका मिला।
क्योंकि पार्टी की विचारधारा के बारे में बात नहीं होती है, विचारों का आदान प्रदान होता है, इसीलिए आप एपॉलिटिकल हो के भी, अगर आपका कोई पॉलिटिकली कोई एजेंडा नहीं है तो भी आप उससे जुड़ाव रखते हैं।
मन की बात कार्यक्रम के 50वें संस्करण के मौके पर देखिए हमारा विशेष कार्यक्रम जन के साथ मन की बात, आज दोपहर 12 बजे, शाम 3 बजे और रात 11 बजे सिर्फ राज्यसभा टेलीविजन पर।
इंडिया विद इट्स रिकॉर्ड ब्रेकिंग पॉपुलेशन एंड स्टैगरिंग डाइवर्सिटी is an ideal country for e-governance, where the tools of ICT are helping the country transform into digital India.
For a country like India, especially as you would all have heard about the new digital India, everybody's talking about that. There's been a lot of work done at present on various aspects, basically computerizing the government and making the government using digital means to make the government easily accessible to the people.
Nowhere has e-governance and ICT been more successful as in the Indian Railways. The Indian Railways is the lifeline of the country. Every day close to 23 million people travel in trains. It is one of the busiest and oldest train networks in the world. For decades after independence, the railways continued to serve travelers in the same old ways. Anyone wanted to book train tickets, they would have to visit the railway station, stand in long lines where services were often slow. Or they would have to get bookings done via touts who charged extra.
Reservation counter pe jaiye, pehle poochtaach kijiye, inquiry.
We would have to go to the reservation counter and make inquiries. After that, we would have to get into another queue to book the ticket. Process was very time consuming. After all that, we may not even get a ticket because brokers and touts would have made bulk bookings.
But in 2002, all that changed. Indian Railways got a digital makeover, thanks to the Indian Railways Catering and Tourism Corporation, or IRCTC. All ticketing systems were put onto digital platforms. The ticket counter was replaced by computers and smart devices. Paper tickets were replaced by e-tickets. And all payments could be done through secure online transactions.
It was a complicated process. You had to stand in too many long queues at the station to get a ticket. We eliminated all that. Now, you can book a ticket sitting in the comfort of your home. You just need to carry a printout of the ticket to travel.
Now, all customers need to do is log in to the IRCTC website, either via computer or mobile devices. There, they can study the train schedule for the route they want and pick a train. Close to 150 servers are the backbone of the online ticketing system. Among them, there are 27 web servers that handle all the information that pours in daily. These are then connected to 95 application servers. This helps to run all the applications on the website, like booking, cancellation, and PNR inquiry. These are then connected with 6 database servers, 5 mail servers, and 4 cache servers. At this back end of the IRCTC website, there is a blaze of black and forth of information that all happens in a matter of minutes. To give you your ticket. Every minute, nearly 2,000 tickets are processed. Every day, the number is 4 to 5 lakhs. But even this service falls short, especially during peak hours, where the website sometimes falters.
Nobody handles as large a volume of data as we handle. We have a fast delivery mechanism. Our customers get refunds within 3 to 4 days. No one else has such a fast turnaround time for such large volumes. Our system are very secure and there's no possibility of it being hacked.
In a bid to make the ticketing system even more efficient, IRCTC has recently upgraded its servers to make systems faster. How fast? It can now process 7,200 tickets a minute.
When IRCTC started, we used to book 400 tickets a day. Now, we book that many tickets in a second.
And IRCTC's story is not an isolated one. In the last decade or more, many public services have gone digital. From paying income tax to paying electricity and water bills. From applying to universities to applying for bank loans. From availing urban services to agrarian ones. India is embracing the idea of e-Kranti. But there is one major obstacle to this dream. In a country where illiteracy rates are high and digital literacy is extremely low, can India dream of an IT revolution where no one is left behind? After the break, we'll get a small preview of what e-governance in digital India could look like in the future.
जब बन ले तू तब और कर ले इरादा।
भारत से हमारा रिश्ता ये है कि जब यहाँ आता हूँ तो लगता है घर पहुँच गया। अगर हम अपना संस्कृति हम भूल गए तो हमको पता भी नहीं चलेगा कि हम है कौन। We will become a kind of copy. किसी ने कॉपी करके पेस्ट कर दिया हमको उस देश में, तो वो तो हम एक्सेप्ट नहीं करेंगे। नमस्कार, मैं हूँ राजमोहन हॉलैंड से। आप मुझसे मिलिए प्रोग्राम गुफ्तगू में,
सिर्फ राज्यसभा टीवी पर।
ट्वेंटी फर्स्ट सेंचुरी इंडिया इज अ पॉपुलस वन वेयर ई गवर्नेंस इज फास्ट बिकमिंग अ बज़वर्ड। ICT tools are making public services safer, easier to access, and more efficient than ever before. So what can India look forward to on the path to e-governance? Foremost is digital literacy, which means making every Indian citizen aware of how basic ICT tools can be used to access public services. For this, India has recently launched the National Digital Literacy Mission. Till date, over 15 lakh candidates have enrolled and over 10 lakh have completed their training. For those who are digitally literate, there are future-forward services that aim to reduce the amount of paperwork involved in any public service. Services like Digital Locker, a virtual safe that keeps all your public documents secure, be it your voter card, PAN card, driver's license or passport. It even stores income tax returns or any records of the government. To sign up, the user only needs an Aadhaar number for authentication. They can even sign up for the first time by using their Google or Facebook ID. Once the user's documents are saved in the locker, they can be accessed by different government authorities with minimum headache. Today, it isn't hard to imagine a digitally empowered India. But if you still need help envisioning the future, then a visit to Akodara in Gujarat will open your eyes. This is India's first digital village, and it gives an idea of how transformative e-governance and ICT can be. CCTV monitored Anganwadis, ATM linked to the local bank branch, debit and credit card infrastructure in village stores, digitally aided educational facilities, and much more. Today, this is the story of one village in India. As for tomorrow, there may be no limits to what ICT can enable. Please send your suggestions and comments to Vigyan Prasar, A50, Institutional Area, Sector 62, Noida, 201-309. You can also email us at info@vigyanprasar.gov.in.